Hello. Remember my Making a Compiler series? If you have not seen the previous episodes yet, suggest you do watch them now. Otherwise you will be very confused when watching this video. So let's begin with the fundamentals. This compiler targets multiple platforms. Each target architecture has a name, word size, list of registers, and so on as discussed earlier. Then comes the list of assembler instructions, or rather patterns of assembler code. Each pattern accomplishes some particular IR statement in the compiler. It begins with a snippet of assembler code. This particular snippet can solve the IR statement only if the statement parameters match some particular criteria. In my design, the criteria can be one of the following four options: one of select CPU registers, or a memory variable, or a number literal, or the duplicate of some previous operand in the same statement. The snippet may also have side effects. It may clobber some other CPU registers with undefined values. In case multiple instructions fulfill the same outcome, a cost is used to weigh different options. Let us explore in practice how this works. Start with the x86 platform, since that is more familiar to most people. The move instruction, for instance, implements the copy statement pretty conclusively. For zero initializing a register, the XOR instruction is a bit more efficient. And to copy label references into registers, we must use the LIA instruction, because that way we can use the RIP relative addressing mode that is recommended on the x86-64. For negation, the x86 offers a neg operand, but it only works if the source and the target are the same. If the operands are different, we can use multiply by -1, but then the target must be a register. Similar thing happens with the add operation. The target must be same as one of the sources. There is, however, a three operand add operation, although it's sort of underhanded. We can abuse the address decoder to perform the sum of two registers and store the result in the third. But this only works if none of the operands is a memory variable. The INC and DEC instructions can be used as quicker alternatives when operating with +1 and -1 literals. For the read statement, there's not many alternatives. The MOVEZX instruction will be used to read a byte from the memory and zero extend it into a 32-bit register. The store into a 32-bit register will incidentally also clear the upper part of the register, so we can use EAX as the target to affect the whole REX. Similar shenanigans go with the write statement. For the equality test, we can use the combination of CMP and SETE. Because the SETE instruction only sets the lowest 8 bits of the target register, the target register must be cleared first. Slightly different code is required if the target register matches one of the sources. NOP is of course just NOP. The IFNZ is a combination of a comparison and a branch. So far so good. Now let's see what to do with the SNES platform. The TAX, TWI, and so on instructions can be used to move data between any of the three registers. The LDA, LDX, and LDY instructions can be used to initialize any of the registers with a constant value. However, only the A register can load data directly from the stack. It is sort of possible to load stack data into the Y register, but doing so will clobber the X register in the process. The same goes with the STA instruction, which writes data from the A register into memory. Remember, every time the code says mem, it really means stack. We could use globals instead of stack relative variables, but then we could not compile recursion. The priority numbers on each of these lines, in case you are wondering, are arbitrary. They convey my idea of how favorable this instruction is compared to other instructions, and the compiler will use this information later. There is no neg instruction on the SNES, so what we must do instead is subtract from zero. If the value is already in the A register, bitwise operations can be used to produce the arithmetic negation, but it's a bit inconvenient. Arithmetic on the SNES can only be performed on the A register. However, quick increments of plus 1 or minus 1 can be done on any register with a single instruction. The INC operation can also use a memory operand, except if it's a stack variable. However, stack addressing can be turned into indexed addressing by copying the stack pointer into the X register. This clobbers X, of course. Testing whether a variable is non-zero is a matter of testing whether it is greater or equal than 1. This produces the result in the carry flag. I utilize the carry flag here because it is possible the compiler had to perform some logistic operations in order to bring the source value into one of these registers, and the logistics must be undone before the branch. Nearly all of the logistic operations, such as LDA, touched the zero flag, but none of them touched the carry flag. As an option, I also provided the possibility to test a memory variable directly, but in this case there can be no cleanup before the branch. The asterisk shall mark this limitation. If we need the equality test result in a register, boy, that's going to be tricky. I will leave interpreting these snippets as an exercise to the reader. Now, to make sure the list of instruction patterns is minimally redundant, a small change must be done into the IR code. Namely, instructions that are non-associative, that is, their operands can be given in any order, are always specified in a predictable order. I add a non-associative flag into the statement. It simply says whether the read parameters are associative or not. This information will be utilized in the final optimization step, canonization. In this step, each statement will be checked. If the statement is non-associative, its read parameters are sorted. Now is also a good time to convert all init statements into copy statements. Dedicated init statements are not really needed anymore, considering that literals were already made into special parameters in episode 4b. The newly minted canonize method will be added to the list of optimization methods to run. Now, did I say I was going to make the IR code simpler? What I meant to say was that I am going to add some new statement types. An if-ic statement, which combines the effects of ic and if and z, and three new pseudo-statements, which will be used only in the code generator. I will spare you the gruesome details of implementing those. Instead, let's fast forward. Back to the instruction listings. This is the x86 section, and this is how we shall do the if-ic statement. The three extra statements I added were swap, push and pop. Swapping the contents of two variables can be convenient sometimes. So is the possibility to push and pop directly from to the stack without using temporary variables. On the x86, any register or stack variable can be pushed to the stack with a simple instruction. Even number literals can be pushed to the stack. The pop instruction is just as arbitrary. On the SNES, however, things are not quite as awesome. There are no swap instructions at all. Well, there are XBA and XCE, but they do different things. But any of the three base registers can be pushed and popped. Number of literals can be pushed too, if anyone cares. The ific instruction follows the same logic as the if and z instruction, mostly. Some of these clobber the A register, and some of them can only be performed as the last instruction of the statement because they rely on the z flag rather than on the carry flag. There is also the f colon red statement that we will look into later. In the next episode, we will write the part that chooses instructions from these tables to generate the actual program. Because YouTube does not reliably bring the videos from your favorite channels to the recommendations listing on the front page, make sure to subscribe and click the bell icon to not miss new videos. See you again, and have a very pleasant day.